when a paradigm changes, everybody goes back to zero. There are a lot more Indians and Native people here in the United States than there were whites. Now that's been totally reversed. I say, I'd like you to say a prayer for the United States, because we're into some really tough times. And these tough times are going to make life around here look like maybe we're eating the turkey, sitting in a little group on some provided pillows.
Okay, boys and girls, welcome back to the channel. My name's Zach, and in this video, we're going to be reacting to Sandy Munro's most recent video posted on Munro Live yesterday about It's Your Move OEMs. And Sandy goes into a detailed analysis. It's actually a 45-minute presentation. I'm going to be summarizing it in this video. But in essence, he actually compares the game that OEMs, specifically auto manufacturers, play and relates it to chess. Talks about a couple talking points, like the LA Auto Show. He shares about his stock ownership. And he finally wraps it up with his prediction of 2030, who's going to be surviving in that time. So if that sounds interesting to you, make sure to watch to the end of this video. I'll link the full interview down below, 45 minutes. If you guys don't know who Sandy Munro is, first of all, what are you guys doing?
Who are you people?
Second of all, he worked for Ford back in the day in the late 80s, and he saw the Japanese automaker exodus. He actually shared a slide where in 1963, GM had 50% of the market share, followed closely by Ford and Chrysler. And over a short period of time, GM went from 50% market share to 13%.
How do you go from 50% to 13%?
It's being surpassed by Toyota. He's seen it happen before, and he's predicting it's going to happen again, but this time with electric vehicle manufacturers and specifically Chinese OEMs.
In 2030, the players are going to be much different than 2021. China will be the biggest market, and many of the current big fish will be either smaller or gone.
So I found this presentation really interesting. Let's get into the video.
This video was sponsored by HiveMQ. Click the link in the description or go to HiveMQ.com to get started building your MQTT cluster today. You can connect up to 100 devices absolutely for free, start building out your unified namespace, and there's no reason not to get started. Now let's get into the video.
So Sandy starts off the video by saying, first, we're walking into dangerous territory. Like I said in the intro, he's seen this happen before in the 80s when the Japanese automakers took market share by leaps and bounds because American automakers were playing checkers and the competitors were playing chess.
I'm not kidding when I say that we're walking into some really dangerous territory. It looks rosy now, friends and neighbors, but I can tell you the same thing happened just before 9/11. And the same thing happened before the stock market fell to pieces or the banks melted.
He also shares that he's a stock investor, specifically in Tesla. So let's see what Munro has to say about that.
Another warning. I own Tesla stock. And you know what? If you're an idiot, don't buy it. If you're a fool, don't buy stock. Don't. Stay at home. Put your money under a pillow. Da-da-da-da-da. It's the
one and only Deagle Double G. Sandy often talks about paradigm paralysis on his channel. Specifically, that's what the auto manufacturers are experiencing right now. There's a new paradigm, and the manufacturers, the OEMs, are physiologically incapable of taking action. It's not just a mental thing. Well, it's a mental thing too, but it's also like it's a physiological phenomenon. It's actually called the scotoma, but let's see what Sandy had to say.
And based on the paradigms that came out when the Japanese car companies came in and annihilated, and that's the word that has to be used, annihilated the big three. So the question is, what is a paradigm? A paradigm is a set of rules and regulations that determine the way you think. If you have strongly held rules and regulations, but the rules change, you'll experience something called paradigm paralysis or paradigm blind, or the real term, scotoma.
So one of the major auto manufacturers that is in deep scomatosis right now is GM. That's being fueled also by administration telling lies about who's leading the EV revolution. If you guys missed last week's video, make sure to go check that out. Sandy then also drops a couple more bombs on General Motors, General Morons, or Government Motors, whichever you like to prefer to call them by. He drops a couple bombs on them by, they actually went to the LA Auto Show this year. They actually purchased one of the first Chinese EVs, so they're gonna take it back to their shop and tear it down and take a look at it. But General Motors' booth was completely empty. And this was supposed to be a EV-focused auto show, and General Motors claims to have 20 new EV models out by 2030, and they did not have a single electric vehicle at the auto show.
Well, let's take another part of that same organization. This is the LA Auto Show with an EV theme. There wasn't a single EV in there. GM promised 20 new EVs by 2023, and they brought zero of that to the LA Auto Show. Now this is electric. Basically, that there was nobody there. Nobody there. You can see a couple of GM guys walking around looking at their own prized vehicles, but nobody came into that area, not while we were there. So you can find Waldo or anybody else. Good luck to you.
They had electric charging station for phones, but they also had three engine cutaways.
There were three engine cutaways and lots of ICE vehicles, but no EVs, no battery technology, no Mary, no President Biden, no people at any of the booths or the cars.
Internal combustion engine, ICE cutaways. So they really missed the ball here. There seems to be a direct conflict of like their marketing team and their event squad and what Mary Barra is telling us. So there's obviously some misalignment within that organization.
GM marketing, I guess, didn't get the news.
The second bomb that Sandy drops on General Motors is talking about how they developed a 3-liter diesel engine. And you want to know how much that cost for them to develop? Well, let's just hear it from Sandy himself.
Want an example? GM and FEV developed a new 3-liter engine. How much does it cost to develop an engine? How long does it have to be in production before an ROI? Development is $1 billion plus, and payback is 10 years minimum.
$1 billion. And the payback time on that is actually 10 years. So for another 10 years, they're going to be incentivized to create cars that have this 3-liter diesel engine, which I don't know who really wanted that anyways. Regardless of that fact, they are financially incentivized and motivated to get a return on that investment. $1 billion may sound like a lot, but it's actually not when compared to the total debt of the auto industry. Sandy pulled up a slide that showed all of the automotive industry debt.
How in the world would you ever think about paying $260 billion back?
It's led by Volkswagen Group with almost $260 billion of debt, closely followed by Toyota and Daimler or Mercedes. Then we have Ford and GM with $160 billion and $110 billion of debt, respectively. The smaller numbers of the pack are Suzuki with only $3.7 billion, Kia with $9 billion, and Tesla with $11.7 billion. Now, before you start getting your panties in a bunch saying,
oh my God, Tesla has $11 billion in debt.
Keep in mind that some debt is good. Imagine if Tesla had a way to get $11.7 billion of cash before they built the Gigafactory Berlin or Gigafactory Texas. So some debt is good, but that brings up the question, how much debt is good debt versus what's bad debt? Obviously, spending $1 billion on a 3-liter diesel engine when ICE engines are going out to pasture like really quickly was not a smart use of debt.
You're an idiot.
But this is when Sandy brings up the Altman Z score. And essentially what the Altman Z score is, it's a function of different key performance indicators as a proportion of total assets and weighted with different averages to get you an Altman Z score. And if you see, I'll pull up the slide now.
This is how you create the Altman Z score.
The Altman Z score formula is working capital divided by total assets times 1.2 plus retained earnings divided by total assets times 1.4 plus EBIT or earnings before interest and tax payment divided by total assets multiplied by 3.3. So that one has a heavier weight plus total equity's market value divided by total assets times 1.6 plus 0.999 times total sales divided by total assets. And this gives you the Altman Z score. Now with this here, you can notice that each one of these numbers is weighted by 1.2, 1.4, 3.3, 1.6. So it'd be really hard to get a score of like less than 1 or even less than 2, assuming that you don't have a bunch of assets that are not efficient. Guess what Tesla's score is? I'll pull it up on the screen now. Tesla has an Altman Z score of over 14. Now, compared to the other auto manufacturers, Honda is just under 2, Toyota's just under 2, Daimler, GM, Volkswagen, Stellantis, Hyundai, Ford, BMW are all right hovering around 1. So what that means is they have a ton. The only way to get that score is you have a really high denominator, right? The total assets that they have is huge. So they're not efficiently using those assets to create a lot of profit, to create a lot of sales, to create a high market cap value. This is a really interesting formula. If I were an auto manufacturer, I would be calculating what my Altman Z score is in real time. I would be using data and information to make decisions, and I would know if I'm in the marketing department, how is what I'm doing today impacting our Altman Z-score? If I'm in the engineering department, how is what I'm doing today impacting my Altman Z-score? It's a very efficient number because it takes into account all of the assets that these companies have, which a lot of their assets are funded with debt. And as you can see, they're not very efficient at using those assets to make profit, to make shareholder value, to make sales, etc. Tesla is in a whole nother league. This is where Elon Musk would say, it's an order of magnitude higher.
Look at the numbers that are associated with this. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to say, I can't believe it. How could they possibly make this happen?
Let's move on. One of my favorite parts of the presentation is when Sandy breaks down the chess analogy. And let me kind of explain real quickly what the different pieces represent in the chess analogy. So the pawns represent the investors. They're front of the line. They're the most vulnerable. They can't really do much. They can just move forward. So they're the first to get cut out, right? Pawns are operating with limited information. And so they're the front line. Your rooks are your assets. And he talks also about how some companies have so much assets, like they're too big to fail. And he also says that Americans are tired of bailing out the big boys. There shouldn't be a concept of too big to fail. What there should be is accountability and profitability in these companies. Until we eliminate this too big to fail concept, Mary Barra is going to continue to run GM right into the ground and walk away with a golden parachute. Next in line, we have the bishops. Those represent the tier community, tier one automotive, tier two, tier three. Sandy also likes to point out that tier two and tier three are really going to get squeezed. Tier one automotive might survive, but they're going to probably do so by insourcing a lot of the tier two and tier three automotive works.
The OEM doesn't necessarily have to keep them. They're just, to the OEM, they're just a commodity.
Moving on next, we have the knights. Knights represent new technology. When you're first playing chess, everyone says look out for the knights because they move in an L shape. So new technology is coming out in left field and it's disrupting the industry. You always got to watch out for the knights. They're kind of a pain in your ass. The king. The king is the OEM, right? The king is the auto manufacturer. They're limited. They can only move one space at a time. If someone captures your king, it's game over. But the king is most protected by the queen. And the queen in this example is like your finances, right? It's the CFO. It's the most powerful piece on the game board. And if the queen sneezes, the king gets some pneumonia, right? If the queen's gone, the king is basically done for.
But the king, unfortunately, is not very nimble.
So I really like that chess analogy, and it was funny because Corey, Sandy's business partner, was playing chess against himself during this whole interview, so it's kind of interesting video. I really like the production quality on that video. The next point in the video is kind of interesting, really hit home. Some of you guys may know I have a 5-year-old daughter, and she was basically born with an iPad in her hand. That's not a hyperbole, that's literally, she came out of the womb with an iPad in her hand. She was born with technology, right?
Try and listen to your kids more about what they think that the future is holding. And they'll tell you that it's going to be EVs.
Right. And when I ask her, she always says electric vehicles are going to be the future. Right. She could tell that cars are sort of old. Right. When we play this game and we're driving around Salt Lake City, like who could find the first Tesla? You know how you used to play like Slug Bug?
I love playing Slug Bug. I get to hit my big brother and he's not allowed to hit me back.
We say, oh, look, there's a Tesla. Oh, look, there's a Tesla. So we're fascinated by this technology. And Sandy points out that if you want to know where the future is going, just ask the kids. And kids that were born in with iPads in their hands are going to grow up to become to driving age and probably aren't ever even going to have to drive a car, much less an internal combustion engine car. It's going to look legacy. It's going to look like how we look at horses, right? It's a fun thing to drive, but I wouldn't use it for my daily transportation. That would be insane.
It'd be like owning a horse in 3 years. I mean, fine if you want to own a horse, but you should go into it with that expectation. Really fundamental message that consumers should be taking today is that it's financially insane to buy anything other than a Tesla. If you buy a car that does not have the hardware necessary for full self-driving, it is like buying a horse. And the only car that has the hardware necessary for full self-driving is a Tesla.
So now we're going to get into the final portion of the video where Sandy, he brings up some charts that industry experts have made talking about the phase out of ICE technology and the explosion of electric vehicle technology. Sandy also does his own prediction, and Sandy really sees two scenarios. One where Chinese auto manufacturers really start to take hold in the United States, and the second one where Chinese auto manufacturers start to nationalize, and that creates more opportunity for North American auto manufacturers to capture market share. So the pie chart with the top 10 in the 2030, Sandy predicts that China would have 26% market share, closely followed by Tesla with 20%. 21% market share. So this is a scenario where we obviously want to avoid. You know, our mission is to help save and create jobs in the United States by helping manufacturers do more with less. We believe that manufacturing is key to a healthy, thriving middle class. And if we are buying all of our vehicles from China, we're going to be supporting China's middle class and ours is going to suffer. Same thing as like what happened in the 80s. So we want to prevent this. So in scenario two, if China nationalizes, Sandy predicts Tesla will gain 35% market share by 2030, then closely followed by Ford at 10%, Toyota at 10%, Hyundai Kia at 8%, Honda at 7%, Nissan at 5%. Noticeably, General Motors is missing from this pie chart. Then 15% for new entries, think Rivian, Lucid, etc., and 10% others. So this is the ideal scenario. So the reason why 4.0 solutions exist is to help manufacturers do more with less. Our goal is to help manufacturers in the United States do more with less. If you are in another country, we would advise you, if you watch this channel, to make your goal to help your country do more with less, right? And so this is why this matters. This is why when Sandy made that video, the first thing I did was I clicked it, I took notes, and I wanted to summarize it and prepare this synopsis for you guys. We're also going to be interviewing Sandy on the channel in the month of December, so make sure to subscribe if you guys want to catch that interview. But yeah, this is really important. So let me know what you guys think of this synopsis. I'll leave a link to the full video down below. Sandy sort of ended the video on a very somber note. The reason why I made this video is because we don't want to have what happened in the 80s with the Japanese automotive manufacturers taking over and crushing the US market share. Like, look at what happened to Detroit. Look at what happened to the United States. We lost a ton of jobs. We don't want that to happen again. That's why 4.0 solutions exist, is to help manufacturers do more with less, to help save and create jobs in the United States by doing that, and by helping educate people like you to do that in your country. So thanks so much for watching. Let's take action. Let's help save and create jobs. Let's innovate with manufacturing. And make sure you guys join the community Discord down in the description box below. We just reached 3,000 members today. I'm really thankful for that. It's a thriving community. It's all about technology, integration, manufacturing. We have a ton of different threads with different subtopics like 5G, additive manufacturing, wireless, digital transformation, unified namespace. You guys name it, we talk about it on that Discord. So if that sounds interesting, make sure to join that and get subscribed to catch the interview that we have coming up with Sandy Munro next month. I'm really looking forward to that, and we'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.